to Chris Kenfold for inviting me to speak here, and to Lika for doing all the background work. Made it so much easier. So I thought that this would be a good topic to talk about, give you our perspective of how we do things. It's not necessarily the best way. Other people might do it better, but this works for us. So to start off with, what's my definition of a sustainable landscape? And it's a landscape that requires an acceptable level of long-term maintenance, and it's dependent on the expectations of the client. So basically it comes down to money, but of course the less maintenance that's required is better. So what's the most important ingredients for creating a sustainable grass landscape? And for me, these are the three most important parts of this presentation. Soil testing, especially of sites that you're not familiar with. If we go out and do a quote in the middle of summer for a site that we're not familiar with, soil testing can tell us a lot of things. And it's, we've heard before about site history from Wayne. Understanding the history of the site is extremely important before you go throwing a lot of money at it, throwing out of grass. Clean, viable seed is absolutely important. There's no point. We've been asked to harvest a stiver in the middle of summer when there's no seed on it. Some people don't understand how important clean, viable seed is. And appropriate site preparation, which I think is paramount importance, and it's something that I don't think it's really understood well. So starting with soil testing, and so I save a lot of money and time. It can actually be the point where you decide not to do the project. Soil testing is that important. We're compiling a database of soil tests from around Melbourne to determine viability of future projects so that we don't keep on getting soil tested. And it's getting to a point where we know what soils work better than others. And a good case study of that is what I'm calling X-Road Pipeline. I won't go into any details of where it was, but construction contractor omitted soil testing to save money, even though it was specified in the revegetation plan. The revegetation plan allowed only one spray at the site preparation. It started hearing alarm bells going off my head. Asked us to sow immediately, and the reason was is they'd forgotten about it, and it was kind of, these are earthquake construction people, with the bit at the end of the native grass really not much interest to them. Subsoil is used on the pipeline surface is unsuitable for growing native grass. It's not always the case, it's sometimes a really good thing, but in this case, this is what the soil looked like. And we did do some soil tests, and this soil did grow native grass there. But the structure was that when it dried out, it just crumbled, and it completely dried out, and all of the germinates would die. So here's the site. Here's my business partner Graham. He's the geologist in the company. So we took a soil sample from the crop over the fence, the disturbed soil, which was remnant grass sand on the roadside, and the post pipeline. And put them in L4 trays, nice and simple, wet them a few times, dried them out, and you can see the difference in the soil structure between them. So we also put some native grass seed in there just to see how it actually goes. And even the pipeline soil grew native grass seed, but only because it was kept wet for long periods of time. So the sort of soil tests that we get, weed germination tests, we do them ourselves because we can actually get more information. But on the left-hand side, you can see a number of different test sites. The depth from which the soil samples are taken, which is very important in this situation, and we'll actually see the site that these samples were done for later on. Days for till germination. And the weed types, and in this case it's just saying it's a broadleaf or a grass weed, where we would like to know what sort of grass weeds they were. And looking down the days of germination and weed type, you've got nil, and you think, oh great, that's good because it's a clean soil sample, but it might not actually And so we look at some more in-depth analysis of the soil, and you can see down the bottom that the green figures are in the normal range, the pink and the grey are actually outside the normal range. So there's actually a lot outside the normal range. However, all of this, this all we've grown out of grass as well. This is how scientific we get. You can see lots of trays with soil in them. Some of them have got native grass seed in them, and some of them are just specifically germination tests to see what weeds come up on the site. And that's a little site where we hold plant stock, and that gets watered regularly. So, Now, so the next thing is clean viable seed. So good quality native grass can be sourced from remnant vegetation or commercially from trusted seed crop. We don't like harvesting good quality remnant vegetation. I've been out to good quality grasslands and seeing two other contractors out there driving all over a good quality grassland. Seeing Trilobus macrocephalus, a really beautiful plants like that, just being squashed by contractors' tyres, and that's why one of the main reasons why we started our own seed production. And commercially, commercial seed growers, you can come to our seed production area and look at our seed production any time you like. People are welcome to come and see how we do it and get engaged in themselves, how clean our seed is. Here, a couple of photos of our seed production area. You can see lots of different species there. The amount of effort that goes into keeping that weed-free or as close to weed-free as possible is why native grass seed is expensive. Probably the main reason why it's expensive. It's another shot of some of the other C3 crops. So if you don't have control of the harvesting of seed, i.e. you don't go out and actually see what seed's been harvested, if you send someone else out, you don't know what you're going to get. So insist that the seed is certified, and that should be the same from seed growers like ourselves. Certified and using seed certificate, and the sort of information that you really want to know is, so we've got Vitetta sperma, it's from Sydenham. It's the percentage of pure seed is 86.3%. Other seeds are traced, which generally means less than 0.1% of the sample. And we look down and see other seeds are right to the sperm d'Artoniana, which is actually supposed to be in that seed mix anyway. So in this sample, we actually have no weed seed at all. So that's they're really important figures to know. There's other stuff, germination, over 30 days, dead seeds, but those figures that I showed are the most important ones. And then our favourite topic, site preparation. And we held a forum about 3 years ago. We call it starting from scratch, and that's what we call site preparation or the weed site. And we'd like to actually, it's all about getting rid of, eliminates or reduces weed molecules and sometimes excessive nutrients from the site before seeding it with indigenous species. So I do believe that if you test the soil, you use good seed, and then you do really good, proper site preparation, that you can't really go wrong. And that's really the way we run our business. So adequate site preparation is, as far as I'm concerned, the key to successful direct seeding, and the quality of site preparation is almost always directly proportional to the amount of post-sowing maintenance required. If you've got an offset site, you've got 10 years to work on that site, and it's weedy and direct seeding is part of it, I would rather spend 8 or 9 years doing site preparation and have 1 or 2 years of maintenance rather than do two years of site preparation and then 8 years of maintenance. Because if you don't knock out that weed seed factor, it's there for good, basically. And you can go through and spot spray it for ever and a day. So at the end of that 10-year period, if you haven't got rid of that weed seed factor, it's just going to go back to it as soon as the monkey is taken away in the same organism. So methods of site preparation in order of effectiveness, and I know that also removes excessive nutrients if they're present. the second one, inversion of the soil profile, which we saw before with the pipeline. So as long as you test the soil and you know that that soil is going to be okay, it's exactly the same as scraping and scaling that also removes excessive nutrients. And if you're going to plant walls with your native grass seed, if you've got excessive nutrients, the grasses will outcompete. They will fill in all of the intertussock spaces and they'll outcompete walls. So those two are a must if you want wildflowers as well, if you're doing restoration, grass restoration. Now, eliminating soil setback using chemical means, aqua fumigation there, unless you're a strawberry farmer, you're probably not allowed to use fumigation anymore. Methyl bromide is currently only for strawberry farmers now. But we've been using other methods too, so we've been playing around with pine oil in large kind of doses, actually watering the ground with it, and it does kill some weed seeds. And also with water, we've been doing some work with solarizing, and I think that's really promising. And I want to talk to someone about solarizing H. Burns from Warren Water, who's just asked a question before. I'm going to have a chat with him. It's looking really promising, and we're really looking forward to doing more work with solarizing as a form of site preparation. So the last two, we've got repeated spraying and cultivation, that's what we generally do, and repeated spraying. So these two last ones, they're variables to determine the time needed to reduce weed seeds using these methods. So these two methods, although they're the most common ones, have the least control over the soil seed bed. Some of the variables are persistence of weed species. If you've got seeds with dormancy, like some of the Celebella grasses, we've sprayed the sites for 5 years and still haven't come up after that. So depending on what sort of weeds you've got growing on the site, might depend on how long you want to do the site preparation using spraying or spraying cultivation. Rainfall during the site preparation phase is really important. We had 10 or 12 year drought. You could have done site prep over that whole drought period and then sown and then the drought breaks, and then all of those weeds that you didn't get to, you were relying on the rainfall to actually get germination of weed seeds so that you can kill it. So if you're not getting rainfall, you're not actually doing anything to weed seed. So rainfall is important. And in site history, as Wayne has talked before, and an example of that is, has the site been ploughed up? Has the seed bank been actually distributed through the soil profile, maybe half a metre down or something like that, with rotary hoe? If that's the case, if you've got a pasture land that's never been cultivated, you can assume that your weed seed's probably in the top 1 or 2 centimetres of the soil. And so you're only dealing with that, but once it's been, distributed through the soil profile, it makes things a lot harder. So land managers need to be flexible, and we have clients now who will put off sowing for another year indefinitely until we are all confident that we've done enough site preparation. Most of the projects that we do have a timeline. You've got 1 year or 6 months for site preparation, then you've got to sow. And sometimes you have to sow and you think, it didn't rain, and we didn't get to do anything with the seed bank. Now we have to sow. And then, of course, you sow and then it rains and all the weeds come up. And you sort of think, well, what a waste of time and money that was, for managers to have an understanding of the triggers, I suppose, or the factors for how long you need to do site preparation, it's really important. And like I said before, we don't recommend including falls and seed mix when using doing spraying and cultivation or just doing spraying. And I'm probably preaching the converted here, but just in case there's anyone here that's a bit worried about direct seeding versus planting. Direct seeding is much lower cost per area, usually much higher density of plants per area, instant seed bank of desirable species, risk is much lower than planting. And a good example of that is we sowed a red grass crop one autumn, expecting to get some more warm weather. The weather went cold, red grass didn't germinate. We just spent the whole winter and beginning of spring spraying those bays, and then when the weather was ripe, all the seed came up. So seed will sit there in the ground, unless it gets eaten by ants or something like that, it will sit there until the conditions are ripe. Whereas once your tube stock has died, there's nothing left, gone. So an example of cosmic area, say a quarter of a hectare of coral on one hand, sowing 500 grams is enough to do that. This is assuming that both sides have had a really good site preparation. You're looking at around about $175 for 20 plants per square metre, and here I'm assuming that it sells these days are worth about 50 cents, I'm not 100% sure. But we're looking at 5 plants per square metre for over $6,000. So sowing actually ends up being 10 times cheaper than planting. And when it comes to a large scale project, you really wouldn't consider planting anymore. And so what does a quarter of a hectare of coral lab look like? Our seed production area is a quarter of a hectare. It took one person about half an hour to say that, rather than a team of people out there planting. Started from scratch at Fjords, our seed production area before we started working on it. It used to be a market garden. It has that problem where we know the site history is that wheat seeds being grown and rowed into the ground, so there's nothing we can do about that. Started site preparation in March 2008. Sowed first crops in 2009. Sowed them again in 2010 because of drought and lack of irrigation. So we got a dam built. So we irrigate during the summer, then and then of course the drought broke and then went like crazy. Site prep is boom spraying and cultivating. And of course the crops are the most site prep for the most food prep. So here's a view you actually saw from the escarpment down before. And this is what it looks like now. So you can imagine the amount of work that goes in to make it look like that and to produce almost work free seed. I don't believe in seed. So at what point do we consider starting from scratch? So when you go out to the site, you look at it and you think, oh, let's just do spot spraying here. But is there a cheaper way? Is there a cheaper way of just spot spraying as part of management? And not just cheaper, but maybe better. So we consider starting from scratch, but weed density to make continual maintenance uneconomical. Weed density is a little different depending on species. So Chilean nettlegrass, maybe 20% before you want to start from scratch. With the flowers, about 50% because it's not such a persistent weed. So here's another case study, Lake Roy grass and Western Treasury plant, maintenance of large flowers of Swatica, about 50%. So we have succeeded on the site, and the maintenance budget was incorporated into the existing budget, so it didn't cost the client very much more than the normal site maintenance anyway. So here's a photo of it. You can see on the right hand side we've got solid Polaris, on the left hand side we've got solid Osprey Scyper Virginiculata, and in the middle we've got sort of a mix of the two. So the site was burnt. I staked out the solid Polaris. You can see the tie marks and the boom sprayed it. The middle was spot sprayed so that we could keep as much remnant grass as possible. There it is, spot sprayed, and this is the middle of the solid Polaris area after a couple of years. I haven't seen it for quite a while, but I suspect that's sort of blended into the rest of the grass there. That's much cheaper than having a team of 5 people out there spot spraying in track packs. Just have one person in a car with a boom spray, much cheaper. So Sydenham Park, their paddock, originally covered in serrated tussock. It was known as the tussock paddock. The department had warned the council they were going to fine them if they didn't do something about controlling it. This is what it used to look like. This was 4 years later. We sowed 10 hectares of it in the first in that year, and another 5 hectares had another year cycle. And that was just because they didn't have enough seed, they didn't afford enough seed to the other 5 hectares, so it just held off another year. And this is what it looked like in November 2013. There was a range of mix of grass species in there. You can see some dicotyledons and lots of dicotyledons there. Now, this is the site I was talking about where once we cultivated it, Chilean nettle grass came up. And we think, well, this is the tussock paddock. What's Chilean nettle grass doing in there? But it was lying there dormant until we actually cultivated the soil. And the Chilean nettle grass was actually coming up in the furrows where the pines had gone through the soil. And there was native snipers came up too. We've got a pretty decent sort of seed dormancy as well. So in summer, it looked like this. The land manager out there was worried about this Chilean nettle grass. Spent so much time planning on this site, so he actually got a small excavator out there and scalped the areas with Chilean nettle grass, took the soil away, and he sowed it with wildflowers. And some polyvers, he's got some endangered species too, some large fruit ground cell and some local rare dianellas in there as well. So it's turned what is a great custom paddock into something that's quite special. So we're preparing another 30 hectares for Brickbank, and then we've got another 10 hectares down on the river place that we'll be doing after that. So they're sold on that here. So we might consider starting from scratch where the site's been altered by earth moving. And this one is the E14 Barton Stage 1 at the Greenvale Reservoir, 3 hectares of direct seed under jute mat. The site was covered originally with Chilean nettle grass, so we did soil testing. That was the soil test results that we saw before at different depths. It was carried out to determine the locations and the depth that would yield the best point-free topsoil. Now, this is the very beginning of it. You can see what we do. We use our seeder with a pipe on it to blow seed out onto the ground, and then we roll down the jute mat. It was a terrible job to do because this jute mat is thin jute mat, it's a 280 GSM jute mat. It's like rolling tissue paper out in the room, and it will rip if it gets wet. It's horrible stuff. And if you, the next slide, we've done that a little bit, and so the bud goes right up around the top here, and it keeps on going all the way to there. When you get to the end, you turn around and you do the other side. I went on 3 months holiday just at that stage, and they finished about a week before I got back to the festival. So on Monday, I went out and photographed the bun. This is what it's looking like now. It's about to flower. It's a mix of dicanthium, so silky bluegrass and walnut grass, because they want grass growing actively all year round. And the idea was that we might have to sow in the summer, so we've got a C4 grass, then that might give us an advantage. So then we've got the next stage, this is stage 2. We were forced to sow in mid-summer. There's 2 hectares this time. Native grass, we never wanted to touch or see jute matter ever again, so we used a compost that was blown onto the site with tack and fire and greening agent. We were told that this would be, that it holds 10 times its weight in water, and we thought, well, that sounds like a really good thing to do in the middle of summer, because the site was being watered quite with a water tanker. The soil testing was done after the top soil was stockpiled. So the contractor got in there and stockpiled the top soil before we could do soil testing. So basically, they just got the weedy stuff. We didn't get a chance to actually figure out what depth. And of course they save money because there's a lot of money around. They don't want to save money, they'll spend money on trying to get weed-free soil. So weeds are competing native grass before they can be established. So here's the mulch being put out, and in hindsight I look at that compost and it's black. And in summer, what's it going to do? It's going to heat up and all the water that goes in is going to evaporate out, and I think that the water is evaporating as hitting in the compost. So in the end, it didn't end up being such a good idea. And that's what this fund looks like now, is this company in the right. But to my horror, we went out and had a look, and here's a company spraying annual ryegrass over the area in front of it, but they're spraying the bund as well. So it didn't just get sown with native grass, but the same with annual ryegrass too. So there was a lack of communication between the companies working on there. And I did find a little area that didn't have any ryegrass growing. I don't know if you can see the bulge grass. I think the sperm are actually jumping up quite well there, so it drives me mad sometimes. So Mike considered starting from scratch when resistant weed threatened highway remnant vegetation. And here's another slide next. It's approximately half a hectare in size. It's got a small core of remnant vegetation that's threatened by my old favourite Chilean needlegrass again. This is what it looks like. The red dot is the size of the remnant vegetation. Its current management is spot spraying with an annual budget of approximately $12,000 a year. That's a really good budget for just here. However, it's not enough to do anything per year, though really valuable. So the site's remained stable for the last 5 years. But is it sustainable? If we stop spot spraying, what would happen to Chilean needlegrass would come back and would turn back to exactly what it was. So I thought, maybe 10 years, it was $120,000, that's a lot of money to actually tread water, basically what's going on. So I thought, on a site like that, with a highly invasive, persistent weed like Chilean needlegrass, what if we were to scrape that site? And I don't think it would cost $60,000, but I put $60,000 on it to remove that weed seed bank, and then your maintenance costs are greatly reduced over time. So by about year 5 or 6, you're saving money after that. And at the end of it, you're paying probably about $50,000 you're saving over 10 years. And instead of just treading water and not actually getting anywhere, you've got a highly diverse, planting or sowing with lots and lots of different species complementing that tiny little remnant that we saw for much higher ecological outcomes and saving money over the long term. And I know that you guys who work for councils are stuck with your annual budgets, but to me this explains how crazy that is. And I sort of think to myself, what if you've got money from sites that probably aren't really worth spending a lot of money on it? Pull them into one, save money, and then start doing it to other sites. And we all know good old Paul in his work on grass native restoration, and what he has done with high diversity grass native restoration. And here's a photo of what he's done out in the Western District. That site there is on par with probably some of the best remnant vegetation in the grassland out in the Western District. And so why aren't we doing that in the urban areas where there are funds to do things like this? Why don't we do something like that, which is more sustainable? It costs more money up front, but it's more sustainable and cheaper in the long term. And the last one, the reason why we might consider starting that is to create innovative landscape solutions for urban spaces. And here's a reserve in Wyndham. Basically, all they wanted was a very dry, low rainfall, like you had here in parts of LA. Their parks become dust bowls in the summer. So the idea was to get a cover of perennial grass. They didn't mind about perennial weeds, they just wanted a perennial cover of grass cover. So we sowed it, we did spray it a couple of times, but this is a client expectation thing. Their expectation isn't to have pristine 100% native grass. There can be weeds in there too, so long as it was presentable. So we've got a good strike rate with the wallaby grass. We boom sprayed out the broadleaf weeds. This is what it looked like at the end of the first spring. We've got lots of wallaby grass coming up. This is what it looked like during this photo is showing what it looked like without spraying in the foreground, and so it's conceding. And you can see the line where the native grass starts at the top half there. So that's exactly what they wanted. So their expectations were there. So another sowing, basically. Basically, I guess just a grassland garden. We had Kaikuya roots in there, so I was a bit worried about that. We were supposed to be sowing native grass and wildflowers. So we did some soil tests, and here's our little germination test in a tray. You can see broadleaf weeds, some annual grass, and so we decided not to sow balls, but we planted it after. But here's another sowing versus planting sort of thing. So we put some rabbit proof fencing around the sowing just to make sure the rabbits didn't get it. And you can see that the plant area has been mulched too. That's a cost that I didn't factor in before, so it makes it even more expensive to plant. And here it is. Our native grass has come up really well inside our rabbit proof fence. The planting, you know, not so good, cost a lot more. There's race like the scabra blowing in the breeze, and you can see on the other side of the fence is the same. So fume batters, sustainable solution for steep batters that can't be mown easily. We bought some red grass seed here, which had a lot of something else in it, aristides, so great. This is nice clean red grass that we've done on the other side of the batter. Here's wallaby grass on another batter. This is a mixture of wallaby grass and spear grass that's just coming up. I'm just going to go quickly through this. Mandalay Golf Course, we sowed the roughs there. I don't think it's going to be sustainable because the site preparation wasn't there, they just wanted it sown. But can you imagine losing your golf ball in there? So I think the way that the designers like it. So why the things sometimes go wrong? Poor planning, we get some terrible specifications, and sometimes we look at them and we don't want to pass that, one spray for cycling. So insufficient or incorrect site preparation, bad timing like sowing in the middle of summer, cost cutting, you'll get main contractors doing this by no soil testing like we saw before, insufficient site preparation, low seeding rates. And then you can just have bad luck with drought or something like that. And believe it or not, other contractors are turning out our projects, like the batters you saw, other clients too. You've got two contractors working on, maybe one contractor used to work on the site, and they didn't know that it's native grass, so they just can't spray it. And what makes a successful project? A good management plan contains the best choice of site preparation, has flexibility to change management strategy and length of site preparation, so adaptive management, very important for correct seeding. Site prep, including spraying, should include at least one full season, at least. If it's not possible, seeding should be delayed until a full season cycle has been completed, and that's usually when you get someone who says, start site preparation halfway through winter, and then you don't actually get to do a proper site preparation. And the other thing is weed control needs to be completed with a high degree of continuity, i.e. not spraying or letting weeds actually set seed on site. It just sets you back the whole year. So we're putting out a little newsletter with more information on pine oil and the solar icing, which I think has a lot of promise. So if you want that, or if you want to get in contact with me, you're in Melbourne and you want to come and see the city right here, just drop me an email and we can organise that. So thanks very much.
Discussions, but while we've got this man on his feet, any quick questions? is what do you do with your scraping later with the silicene?
With what, sorry?
What do you do with the scrapings laden with mycelicene?
Oh, right. That's a good question. They can either be put on the side, on top of other nacelle, or they'll be taken to landfill where it belongs. Because really, I consider topsoil, as sacred as we think topsoil is, once it's full of weed seed like that, it's toxic. It's good for absolutely nothing, unfortunately, until we find a way of actually killing the seed in the soil. We can't do anything with it, so it's actually a liability. So it needs to be treated as a toxic soil, I believe. But why not just spread it over an area with more Julian metal grass on it where it's not going to make any difference. So either that, I don't know, Paul just sort of pushes it over to the side. People have a problem with that. You know, if it's got those horrible weeds in it, yeah, it's toxic.
Just two questions. What, you didn't mention much about the cedar you use.
The cedar?
Yeah.
Okay, the cedar we have developed is basically, it's on a off-road trailer, and it broadcasts seed. So it cultivates the soil and just broadcasts seed behind with a blower, industrial or dust extractor. So all it does is blow. This is no different than actually hand broadcasting seed, but you can do it really quickly.
And you cover it again?
Sometimes we'll go over it more than once if the seed can rain. So once it's cultivated, we can stick the pipe up in the air and it'll just blow all over the place, and we go out fairly evenly. So we've gone for a pretty simple method, but it works, especially with lawn seeds. Once the ground's cultivated, it'll work their way into the soil.
And second question. I think one of the early slides you put up, you had a seed rate of 500 grams per hectare. Was that one taller?
Yes. Look, normally we sow at about 10 kilos a hectare, but on our seed production area where we do really good site preparation, we get away with really low seed rate. So that was aimed at a site that's had really good site. Chris?
You had a soil nutrient test up there. What do you have? What do you see as being toxic to consumption of grass and maybe?
Well, that's a really good question, and Ian Chippers probably be able to answer that better than myself. But look, what we do, those soil tests don't really mean a lot as far as native grasses go. In fact, you know, so that's why we actually grow native grasses in the soil. Over a period of time, just to see how they grow. But there, look, we did once do some sowing at a treatment plant, a water treatment plant. It's a sewage treatment plant, actually. We got germination and everything died. And we thought, well, that's funny. We asked people, where did this soil come from? And it actually been dug out of one of their ponds where they'd been. So it was high in boron, salt. They had told us that, but we actually got that soil tested later on. So it will tell you if there's something really, really wrong, and then that'll set off your alarm bell, and that's when you might decide you're not going to do it for it.
Did you want to chip in on that, Ryan?
Yeah, look, I guess my attitude to soil testing is probably varied over the years. I was more inclined to do soil testing earlier than I am now. I look at it and think, if the soil was capable of supporting grass now, well then why am I getting too fussed about whether it's going to be supported in the future? I completely endorse Chris's idea of using a test plot foot to put the soil out and try and germinate and stuff. And I think that's a good indication of whether you can get a success or not.
Soil testing is really important when you're using soil from further down the soil profile, especially when the colour changes and starts. The alarm bells start ringing, and that's when you want to actually know if it's toxic or not. And so soil testing is really good there. But honestly, just a germination test and trying to grow native grass seed. It's cheap, it's easy, and there's no reason why you shouldn't do it. Unless, like I said, you know the site really well, you know what weeds are growing there, assume that it's actually fairly fertile for native grass.
Any other questions? Chris, one of your earlier slides notes you had a situation shift and tripped to the top right there, said it's been pre-chilled versus the dead area. And it looked like, that's a lot of time, right?
CM2 or something, I'm not sure. The person that does our seed testing actually does, crop seed testing is what she normally does. And so she pre-treats, I asked her because I don't know if pre-chilling C4 grasses are a little bit way of breaking the dormancy, but she told me that she does that with all of her seed to break dormancies. I find that a little bit questionable sometimes, but yeah, that's just what she does. So,
Alice talking about that.
Yes.
Yeah, I'll talk about it later.
Yeah, we'll definitely hold that in our minds.
Sure.
Yes.
Yeah, with the seed production areas, so how often do you have to renew your plots? Is there sort of what's the longevity of most of your?
Some species around about 3-4 years. Mm-hmm. Other species just keep on going. Femida, for instance, that's been going for probably about 6 or 7 years now, and it's still producing just as well. Some of them are bigger, just scraping out. Some of them get weedy. Like I was telling some other people, Chloris truncata has become a terrible weed in our crops, and so we're getting rid of our Chloris crop, and we have to basically spray out some crops because we don't want, there's more chloris in them than what's supposed to be in them now. So, but yeah, some of them do lose vigour after a few years.
Do you think it's because it's quite densely planted? I'm just trying to think of, you know, the previous presentation where in the vineyards where after 5 years the grasses had died out and weren't sustaining themselves. Is it because it's sort of dense planting and there's no room in between for recruits? Germinations, or
is
it for some other reason?
There's a lot of recruitment that goes on in our seed production area, so as long as there's intertussock space, you will see new germinants coming up every year. Although it gets harvested, a lot of seed ends up on the ground. And over a few years, you actually see your crops starting to look a little bit more grass, like a grassland where there's actually grasses of different ages. In the first probably couple of years, you will notice your crop. All the grasses are the same age, which is something that I was not used to seeing beforehand. And you'll see, you know, wallaby grass growing this high in a good season. There seems to be this vigour in the first couple of years that drops off after a while. And I think that once you've got different age grasses growing, you've got some that have got more vigour than others, and you get to a point where you think, okay, not getting as much seed off this, so we'll start again. But because you've got that recruitment, that's why I'm sort of looking at these photos of wally grass in the vineyards and it's dying out. Why is the recruitment going on? That's some question that I'm sort of wondering.
I mean, have you used fire in your actual seed plots?
We do in some of the C4 species, so we've bred out Femina, as we all know, does lose vigour when it gets thatched. But we also cut and bale all of our crops every year, and so we can, with a haymower, we can actually cut it very short, which will get rid of all of that thatch. And it being done every year means that the thatch doesn't build up, so it does keep crops bigger, a lot higher.
Where does that find its way to your paling?
Ian knows all about that too. There's a huge demand for native grass hay for horses because a lot of problems they have with high rate grass.